When Elvis Presley first burst upon the scene, he was a force of nature, a musical sensation whose blend of country, pop, and R&B truly earned him the title of the King of Rock and Roll. Now, in a new documentary aptly titled The King, award-winning filmmaker Eugene Jarecki goes on a road trip across America in Elvis's own 1963 Rolls-Royce Phantom V. With movie stars, musicians, and everyday Americans in the passenger and sometimes the driver's seat, Jarecki gives us a once-in-a-lifetime ride and a truly unique view of the King and of America. Here's a look.
You have no idea of how hard he hit American culture.
And the guy had it all. Rich, famous.
Every chance he prioritized money. And where did it put him? Dead and fat on the toilet at 42.
He is a living metaphor of the American story.
Work hard, you get ahead. It's a great lie of all.
This country is so much more complex than we thought.
The King, part of Independent Lens on PBS.
And joining us now is the director of The King, Eugene Jarecki. Eugene, thanks so much for joining us today.
Great to be here.
So, Eugene, you know, most reviewers of The King seem to agree that your film is not so much about Elvis, or not just about Elvis, but about Elvis as a metaphor for America. Do they have it right?
I think so. I mean, that's how we really envisioned what we were doing. I saw in Elvis Presley a metaphor really of the American dream itself. I mean, who more closely sort of represents the American dream than this country boy who came out of nowhere and became, you know, the king. He became the highest of the high. And so in that sense, he represents the American dream as we think of it in the best of terms. But of course, America's going through a lot of convulsion today about who we are, looking deeply inward. And I think Elvis, it's necessary to look at him again, not like sort of critically or mean-spiritedly. It's actually a very big love letter, this film, to Elvis. Mm. But it actually cares about the fact that Elvis died young and was killed and sort of destroyed by the very forces that made him great. And that, I think, is a very American story, too.
Yeah, so you would say that the parallels between Elvis and America are the rise and the fall of Elvis, and the rise and perhaps the fall of America, because a lot of the people in the film think that America is on the downward trajectory. Van Jones, for example.
Sure. I mean, I think that, you know, look at it. Elvis bursts on the scene in the world, and he takes the world by storm, just like the young America did when America came out of nowhere and sort of shook off the cobwebs of a former world. And then he rose, and we rose like a rocket, and all of a sudden he found himself, like America, sort of astride the globe, this colossus with the world in his hand, and he was unprepared for it, just as America, I think, is unprepared for the sort of global leadership role we have. And what does each man and country do? We turn to all kinds of quick fixes to mend these growing fractures in the soul. And in Elvis's case, you know, that was drugs and consumption and materialism and violence and vanity. And, you know, those are all the things you would describe as modern afflictions in America. And I think we see how it ended for Elvis. And I don't want to see the country go down that slippery slope. So I'm here to kind of step in and call for sort of national soul searching.
You know, it's a fascinating concept for a documentary, particularly as you bring it to life in this road trip on the Rolls-Royce. How did you come up with this idea?
Well, to be fair, I wasn't originally making a film that had Elvis's Rolls-Royce in it. I was making a meditative film about Elvis and America, and it would have been a very poetic film with a lot of luminary people in it. There's a lot of people in this film. You can't make a film about Elvis in America without his friends and family and loved ones, hardworking across the country who knew him, and also people like Chuck D. You can't make a film about Elvis in the modern era without having the African-American perspective of what Elvis represents in terms of the black community. So that we were there to make this sort of definitive film on the meaning of Elvis for America. When halfway through the production process, I learned that Elvis's 1963 Rolls-Royce was coming up for auction. They allowed us to buy the car as the film. The film used the car. We restored it at the end and then sold it in a kind of very interesting and symbolic way. And that became another part of the story.
Yeah, but, you know, one of the important themes in the film is the issue of cultural appropriation, you know,
yes.
and the charge that that Elvis was a cultural appropriator because, you know, he reached his fame after he took on the African-American sounds of his youth and made him his.
Yes.
Do you think that he was a cultural appropriator?
No, I don't think so. I take my cue in this from Chuck D, whose wisdom in the film, I think, is he's the most important interview in the film, and he's stunningly intelligent and also emotionally and sort of philosophically intelligent. Now, what he says is when Elvis played black music at that time in the 1950s, that was an incredibly courageous and brave thing to do. That's the sharing of culture. And as Chuck says very clearly in the film, you wouldn't tell a young African-American kid not to play Mozart because he doesn't have Austrian roots. That would be to oppress culture. You want to be having us all share each other's music, each other's food. You know, we'd have a lot less war if we all knew each other's culture and shared each other's sort of glory more. But I do think that he missed a trick there where, you know, sort of Marlon Brando didn't, Jane Fonda didn't, Charlton Heston didn't. They stood by the black community, and the black community needed them, and Elvis Presley wasn't there for them in quite the way. Now, in an interpersonal level, he had a lot of black friends, he helped black musicians. That's not the problem. This is as an international icon, the most important icon of its time. He was glaringly absent from the activities that others were deeply involved in.
All right, Eugene, we'll have to end it there. As I said, it's a fascinating film. Thank you so much for joining us today to talk about it.
Thanks for having me.
The King premieres on PBS on Monday, January 28th at 9 p.m. For additional airtimes and other viewing opportunities, you can visit our website at metrofocus.org.